Today, you can sell your worn-out house and buy truckloads of tulip flowers. However, in 1673, you could sell just one tulip flower and buy hundreds of luxurious villas in Amsterdam. It seems so silly to believe that today, but then people got rid of their life savings, expensive jewelry, and ancestral gold to get their hands on tulip flowers. In 1716, precisely 40 years hence, people would sell their life's possessions once again to buy the stocks of Mississippi Company in France and South Sea Company in England, whose prices were increasing tenfold every year. Just to add on, the great physicist Isaac Newton was also an investor in the South Sea Company. After plenty of incidents on the way, recently in 2008, America, people had taken enormous amount of debt to buy as many houses as they could. Holding period of house in USA was less than 4 months during 2007. With prices of home appreciating by 50% every time the house was sold. Since the start of capitalism in Amsterdam in 17th century until today, all these episodes come with a promise to make people rich quick, adding many zeros behind the net worth by just trading few items, be it art, flowers, collectibles, stocks, real estate, or any other financial instrument. But truth be told, the only certain destination these episodes lead to was excitement and enthusiasm in public, referred to as euphoria. What looks like a get-rich-quick schemes, more often than not, have turned out to be get-poor-quick schemes and caused irreparable loss to people's lives and livelihoods. Certainly, even after having such historic significance, sooner or later, in some form or the other, we see such a frenzy all over again. This book by John Kenneth Galbraith does not give you any tip on how to compound wealth or how to invest to earn great returns on capital. On the contrary, it brings to your notice how you can lose it all and thus how difficult but important it is to avoid that danger. This is The Better Investor, helping you achieve your financial goals and freedom through organizing your finance, stock market investing, and learning from billionaires. And these are top 5 lessons from the book, The Short History of Financial Euphoria, written by John Kenneth Galbraith. Lesson number 1. The making of a bubble. Bubble is referred to as the period when the prices of any assets, say stocks, inflate just like a bubble very quickly with nothing but air in between. The prices look unrealistic, unimaginable, and totally out of proportion from the reality. But the bubble can only get as big. It ultimately has to burst, and thus the inflated prices have to come down to reality. Generally, things don't stop at reality, because the excitement is followed by extreme pessimism, which pushes the prices further lower than reality. When this happens, we say that the bubble has burst. It all starts with a bidding war over some assets a few people believe are so rare and important that their value should only increase in the future. That's after all the basic economic rule. When the supply is low, the demand is great, the prices will rise. Add to this the yearning desire of many people to become rich overnight, and you get a recipe for disaster. Because soon enough, investors join in. Why should they not? It's their job to get the most out of anything, and bubbles are the perfect way for them to earn some money. And since they're usually the earliest players, they actually do make money, and they do it big time. Of course, these investors are not exactly humble people. So they start tooting their own horns, and soon even more people start investing in the asset, the price of which in the meantime has blown ridiculously out of proportions. The scary thing is that in the second group of people, there are usually even quite a few intelligent analysts too, who are aware that at some point in the future, this bubble will burst, but who nevertheless expect to be able to take their money back before that happens. Some do. Most don't. And when the inevitable happens, the market crash, many lose substantial amounts of money. Many more lose absolutely everything. In 17th century, all of a sudden, a virus-infected breed of tulip bulb flower became very popular. Obviously, people then did not think that it was infected, rather thought of it as some special lucky charm. it soon became a symbol of wealth. The virus-infected breed was obviously rare, and people started bidding them in free markets. With only few sellers and trending large buyers, the prices only went up. The trend continued, convincing people that it is the new normal. Everyone wanted to own a tulip before the prices became more expensive the next day. People sold their lands, started growing tulips in place of vegetables in their farms to get lucky to have the virus-infected tulip flower. But obviously, such an occasion was rare. At the peak of optimism, when there were no more optimists left, some sanity returned and prices of the tulips lost almost 95% of their value on a single day. Those who thought of them as rich and wealthy were left with nothing but truckload of flowers which decayed few months ahead, which was most obvious. The frenzy of tulip is referred to as tulipomania, and in the book has been referred to as the very first market bubble. After the tulipomania was over and everyone thought that people have learned their lesson, the strange thing happened. In a decade or so, financial euphoria struck again. Lesson number 2. The short-term financial memory. In every couple of decades, such bubbles are seen. Even when people have lost their fortunes, still such events happen again and again. Because the financial memory of an individual is very short. Apart from that, every decade a whole new group of market participants join in who have never seen such a thing like bubble and crash in the past. All this makes people forget the old pains and builds in optimism of modernism and saying, huh, this time it's different. A very recent example. In 1999, tech companies were the main players of the stock market bubble, with price of Amazon, Yahoo growing 100 times within few years. The crash in the year 2000 took with them economy of most of the countries of the world. Just 7 years hence, in 2007, once again, housing bubble had been built, with people bidding up prices of their homes at insane level. The stock price of real estate companies had gone to the roof. In 2008, once again, the bubble burst, which is referred to as the financial crisis of 2008. Exactly after 10 years, in 2018, similar bubble was formed in cryptocurrency. The price of one Bitcoin increased from $750 in 2016 to $18,000 in 2017. Only to crash to $3,000 by the end of 2018, losing more than 83% of its value. This year, once again, the price of Bitcoin had increased to $53,000, an increase of 14 times in last 2 years. As per the research mentioned in the book, the financial memory of an individual is very short. At maximum, it acknowledges the events 20 years old. Anything older than that looks obsolete and out of time. For example, if you go back in time to 2008, when housing prices were increasing at rampant pace, and caution the people about one similar event, that is 2000 tech bubble burst 7 years back, they would say, those were tech companies, these are houses. This time it's different and prices are to rise indefinitely. In 2018, if you would have told a Bitcoin buyer that a similar event happened in 2008, 10 years back, when the housing bubble burst, he would say, those were houses, this is technology, blockchain is future, this time it's different, the price of Bitcoin will only go up. And even now in the year 2021, just 3 years later, if you tell the buyers of the stock of Tesla, which has already grown by 20 times from $45 in 2019 to $800 in 2021, that such a frenzy happened in 2018 with Bitcoins, they would say again that Bitcoin was flawed. Tesla is about electric vehicle and mind-blowing technology. It's about sustainability. This time, it's different. Galbraith says that be very cautious when people making money tell you this time it's different. Lesson number 3. False link of wealth and intellect. Most people believe that wealthy investors are by definition smart. which is why they have devised all the fancy epithets about the likes of Warren Buffett, Peter Lynch and George Soros. But sadly, in financial history, there is always a specious association of money and intelligence. It's been a hard fact of life that people tend to believe it is their intelligence and not their good luck which is making them grow richer. Money is considered as the measure of capital achievement. A man is considered as accomplished if his pockets are filled with money. It hardly matters how the money has come to him. The richer one gets, the more intelligent he is perceived by the crowd and even by himself. Nassib Nicholas Taleb, a very famous trader and psychologist, the author of two classics, Black Swan and Antifragile, which I intend to cover on this channel later, says that stupid people may sometime get successful, but that does not mean being stupid is the right thing to do. This false sense of being skilled makes the market participants overconfident. They will boast of what strategies they followed to grab outsized returns. They do not realize that it's not just them who is making money, but everyone. The real test of skill of an investor is seen during the crash and bear markets, where assets depreciate in value over years. It is the mark of great investor to be cautious when they see frenzy in the market, because they know that no one in the world has the skill to time the top of the bubble correctly. Staying away on the sidelines during euphoria definitely make them a little less rich for some time, but it ensures safety from the inevitabilities of what follows the stock market bubble, the great crash. Knowing this bias about one's behavior can definitely help us to be sane during times like these. Lesson number 4. The bubbles build conviction. The reason that most investors lose money in bubbles is because bubbles most of the times will convince you that they are not bubbles, especially in the stock market. For example, from 1920 to 1928, the story was that business system of America, which is capitalism, will change the world, and moreover than not, America itself. With most of the Europe barely managing to recover after World War I, the reason for rising of stocks to insane level was because of the optimism that America would become economic superpower. If we see today, America actually became superpower. After that, from late 1980s, the story was that electronics will change the world and Japanese companies like Sony, Samsung, Yamaha would be the biggest beneficiaries of the future since they were industry leaders in electronics. This made Japanese stock market run through the roof. People saw Japanese index rising from 12,000 in 1986 to 40,000 in 1990. You would be surprised to know that even today, after more than 20 years, the national index of Japan has still not reached to where it was in 1990s. Imagine investing your money in a class for 20 years to get negative returns, and that too in the national index, which is considered as one of the most safest. Did electronics change the world? Yes, obviously. Brands like Sony, Samsung, Suzuki are global leaders. Despite that, you had made no money investing in them in the time of frenzy. Similarly, in tech bubble of 1999, the story was that internet would change the world, and it actually did. Today, we cannot imagine in ways internet has made not just our lives but businesses more productive. Despite that, you would have lost all your money in the big tech names, which were so-called best internet companies. Even Amazon gained 100 times in just 1 year. If you were an investor who invested in the frenzy of tech bubble in 1999, you would have actually broken even 10 years later in 2010, the amount of your initial capital. And just for a word of caution, people today are saying that electric vehicles will change the world. You can see this in the price of Tesla, which has already shot up 20 times in last 2 years. So almost all the bubbles have a story which actually is true. The problem is that the market prices it in the stock price as if the change will happen just in a couple of years, whereas businesses take decades to evolve. We must definitely listen to what Howard Marks said on this. He said, "Being too far ahead of your time is equivalent to being wrong." Lesson number 5. Bubbles are inherent part of the market. Though the businesses in the markets change over time, the companies that are leaders today were not leaders 40-50 years back, and it is most likely that they will not be leaders 50 years hence. Technology changes, the time changes. However, market participants remain same, that is humans. And humans, my friend, are driven by emotions of greed and fear. If you are in a room with five of your friends and you see all of them making money, getting rich overnight, you may with your sane mind resist yourself for some time. But when such a thing carries on little longer, it is hard to resist because you will be perceived as a fool by everyone sitting idle and these people making money as wise. When the patience is lost, the non-participating member also enters the game. It is this psychology that drives us into irrational speculation. Thus, one of the greatest quality of an investor is extreme patience. As Paul Samuelson, one of the great economist, investor and Nobel Prize winner said, "In investing, you must have patience so as to stare at the wall and watch the paint dry. If you want excitement, you must take $800 and go to Las Vegas." So we need to understand that speculation is part of the market and it will always be that way. The prospects of short-term quick gain schemes will always lure people, contrary to what many will say. The markets is not infallible since humans are not infallible as well. Regulations can help, but even they cannot contain mass euphoria and gullibility. So as long as there are people in the markets, there will be bubbles as well. And the only way to save yourself from the mass destruction caused by them is to keep a check on your emotions. Let's have a quick recap. All bubbles start with bidding war over some asset a few people believe are so rare and important that their value should only increase in the future. Some experienced and knowledgeable investor who have insight about prospects of a situation invest very early. These are the people who know the correlation between price and value. Slowly, the desire to get rich quick adds up with optimism, making it a recipe of disaster. It is the extreme brevity of financial memory which leads us to forget the financial disasters very quickly. Several stock market crashes have happened in the past where a great many people lost their fortune. Still, we don't learn anything from that. Instead, we quickly forget the last crisis and often commit the same mistake over and over again. Most people believe that wealthy investors are by definition smart. The richer one gets, the more intelligent he is perceived by the crowd and even by himself. This false sense of being skilled makes the market participants overconfident. It is a mark of great investor to be cautious when they see frenzy in the market because they know that no one in the world has the skill to time the top of the bubble correctly. Almost all bubbles have a story which actually is true. It is this story because of which people are convinced that the party will go on forever. The problem is that the market prices the story in the stock price as if the change will happen in the business in just a couple of years, whereas in reality, businesses take decades to evolve. We must not forget that being too far ahead of our time is equivalent of being wrong. Speculation is part of the market and it will always be that way. The prospects of short-term quick gain schemes will always lure people. So, as long as there are people in the markets, there will be bubbles as well. And the only way to save yourself from the mass destruction caused by them is to keep a check on your emotions and practice extreme patience. That's it, guys. If you like the video, please like, share and subscribe. If you have not checked out till now, watch the video of the summary of another investment classic, Common Stocks and Uncommon Profits, which Warren Buffett calls the best investing book ever. You can support me by buying a coffee. Link in the description. I will come again with summary on a book on investing or finance soon. Until then, cheers, guys.